A very good morning to everyone present here. I am Nikit Kozale.
And I am Mehreen Meer.
The senior student secretaries of the Department of Medical Humanities welcome you all to the second foundation day of the Dr. Manuvial Kotari Chair of Medical Humanities and the Division of Medical Humanities. The introduction of medical humanities was a quantum leap in the history of St. G.S. Medical College and KM Hospital. Dr. Manu Kothari was one of the pioneers in this field and a crusader for patients' rights and ethics in modern medicine. It was very appropriate that the chair for medical humanities be named after him. The twin prestigious institutions, St. G.S. Medical College and KM Hospital, were founded on 22nd of January 1926. While Dr. Manu V.L. Kothari Chair and the Division of Medical Humanities was founded today, that is 23rd January 2016. The chair strives to uphold the ideals and principles that late Dr. Manu Kothari consistently stood up for.
In the current scenario, where competition replaces the desire for excellence and the needs to score well surpasses the needs of the patient, it is sensibility and the humane touch which take a back seat. And it is this, combined with the lack of proper communication and understanding, that is making the patient not trust his doctor and is taking a toll on the doctor-patient relationship. Medicine not just treats but also heals deeply. And with this thought in mind, let us begin with our today's program. I would like to invite Shivani Shende and Aradhita Maheshwari for the Ganesh Vandana.
Thank you. Thank you, Aradhita and Sir Shivani, for the marvelous performance. I, Pranav Sarvasay, the Junior Secretary of Medical Humanities, would like to present before you a video presentation on the introduction of the Chair of Medical Humanities prepared by Tejas Saha. City in our country. My proposition today is that the awareness and particularly an acquaintance, if not a deep study of the humanities, makes a better physician. And what exactly do we mean by humanities? Well, it includes history, it includes ethics, it includes literature, poetry, philosophy, religion, perhaps social sciences, art and culture, the visual arts, poetry, drama, animated cinema.
It's unusual to have a doctor who's in a renowned both an artist, a playwright, and also practices his own profession. These two poems are from a set of poems which are a little book, which is called Gadchiroli. The whole book is tilted towards a sympathy for the more humble gods, and as a corollary for the more humble human being who worships these gods.
Guests who will be gracing our today's event. First, the keynote speaker for today is Dr. Abhay Bang, who is known for his selfless work for improving healthcare among tribals in Gadchiroli. He well and truly epitomizes the ideal of medical humanities. Now I would like Niket to felicitate our guest. Our second guest for today is Dr. Avinash Supe sir, who is the Dean of State GS Medical College and KM Hospital and Director of Medical Education and Major Hospitals, MCGM. And our third dignitary for today is Dr. Sunil Pandya sir, who is the Consultant Neurosurgeon at Jaslok Hospital and the Chairman of Dr. Manuvial Kothari Chair of Medical Humanities and Division of Medical Humanities. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Avinash Supe sir for sharing a few words with us.
Respected Dr. Pandya, our Chairman of the Chief of the Humanities Cell, Dr. Abhay Bang, I'm sure everybody is eagerly waiting to listen to him. My close friend, Dr. Anand Narkani, Dr. Rupamhita, everybody who has gathered here to listen to Dr. Abhay Bang today. I think at the outset, let me really say, wow, that performance was excellent. I think that girl, I must tell you, I'm extremely proud of my students for the way they in your eyes when you really see such kind of a talent. KM is known for its talent, and KM is known for, when I remember, many people tell me, Avinash, we know you as a Ghasu, and we also are very Ghasus in our life. But today, I think, over a period of time, we all get exposed to all this art, science, poetry, and we widen our scope. But today what happens, from 8th standard to you become MCH, your whole life becomes strategized, jacketed. You don't look beyond MCQs. Now this is one attempt which our college wants to do, is to expose everybody beyond those MCQ books. And I think let's make this whole effort of humanity cell towards making an rational, socially acceptable, and a doctor who really has an image which Dr. Kothari wanted in his life. I think the whole remembrance of Dr. Kothari is to see what he wanted. And I think I would not speak more because I want Dr. Webang to speak and we all listen. So I'm really happy to be here, and I'm very happy that we are all celebrating this with Dr. Webang. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the kind words. Now I would like to invite Dr. Smriti Bajpai ma'am to introduce our chief guest.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. I've been entitled the arduous task of introducing the speaker to all of you. Dr. Abhay Bang. He's such a humongous persona that to be able to put in few words before him is absolutely impossible. So I won't be trying that. I'll be putting up what have been given to me in small paper for the uninitiated and for the naive like us. Dr. Abhay Bang grew up in Sevagram ashram of Mahatma Gandhi. He was inspired by Gandhian ideology and trained in India in MD, PSM and then in John Hopkins School of Public Health. He was amongst the top notches in the university and won 3 gold medals. Along with his wife, Dr. Rani Bang, who we were privileged to hear last year, founded the voluntary organization SEARCH, stands for Society for Education, Action and Research in Community Health. 30 years ago, in one of the most underdeveloped districts of Gadchiroli in the state of Maharashtra and India, they have been working with people in around 150 villages to provide community-based healthcare and conduct research. They have developed village healthcare programs which are now nationally and internationally famous models. They have led a campaign against alcoholism which led to introduction of prohibition in Gadchiroli. They have even written 2 books, one regarding his own heart disease and which has received state literary award. He is a member of the High Level Committee on Tribal People in India and currently the chairman of Expert Committee on Tribal Health Government of India. He's been awarded some humorous awards, too few to mention. The Time magazine selected him and his wife as the Global Health Heroes in 2005. He's also received Lifetime Achievement Award in a Bharat Healthcare Summit Mumbai of Honorable Chief Minister gave him in 2017. Vidar Bhushan Award, Distinguished Alumnus Award at John Hopkins, Maharashtra Bhushan Award in 2003, to mention a few. With further ado, I would request sir to kindly speak to us. Thanks.
Because his dream was to create not an intelligent doctor, but a humane doctor. And so the department, which is very aptly has been started in his memory, though it is called Department of Humanities, I would like to call it a Department of Humane Medicine. And throughout his life, through his passionate interactions with students, through his very unorthodox ideas, viewpoints which were not very highly welcome in the medical established fraternity, but he continued to, I suppose he continued to tease students' brains to think differently. Medicine that way is a very, very orthodox science. It doesn't change rapidly, and so maybe in other sciences also. So Manu Kothari tried to have interactions with students to create new inquiring brain, questioning brain, creative brain, curious brains. And so I consider it a great honor to talk in his memory. I try to cover one aspect of medicine which probably during our medical education, during our hospital ward rounds and operation theatres, we do not get as much opportunity to get exposed to. And that's why I choose this topic, in search of health and healthcare for the people of India. India has a very unique challenge probably faced by no other country except for China, that we need to provide healthcare to 1.3 billion people located in nearly 1 million villages, hamlets, small towns. Huge population, scattered locations, huge burden of disease. Very recently the global burden of disease study India chapter has been released on 23rd November if I am right. And what is the burden of disease that the Indian population carries? It's a huge burden. And so challenge before us is how to provide care to such large population scattered everywhere. To compound this, there is another challenge. There was a sad news yesterday, one of the saddest news that I have read in my life. In Times of India, it might have got hidden somewhere. I don't know how many people noticed, but news said more than 90% Indian people do not trust doctors, hospitals and healthcare system. This was a no confidence motion against doctors. And so the challenge before us is dual. How to provide healthcare to the people, but also how to become doctors whom people and the patients would trust. And of course there is no one particular model or solution to this, but I am going to discuss this subject with you, especially the first part, how to provide healthcare to people who need, by sharing with you four questions and four stories. So no preaching. My theater So okay, the four questions. This is a new skill I am learning. Okay, so this is what I propose to do. Let me see. Yes, it works. And whatever I'll share it with you is what I learned in the great university called Gadchiroli. And so our theatre of action and our university of learning is Gadchiroli. When I use this word university of Gadchiroli, I did not use it as a polemic or I didn't use it lightly. I seriously mean it. And maybe when I share with you further, you will realize that what I mean is correct. Now let me take you for a few moments to Gadchiroli. Now those who are from Maharashtra would of course know, but some of you might not be from Maharashtra. So here we are, about 1000 kilometers east of Mumbai. At the eastern end of Maharashtra is this district, Gadchiroli. on the other side subsequently is the Bastar area, and then later on is the Orissa. So the nearly 800 kilometer belt of undeveloped tribal forest zone Gadchiroli is a district 300 kilometers long. Dense forest covers nearly 70% of the district, and there are 1600 villages scattered in this huge landmass. Villages usually are of 30, 40, 50, 100 households. Distances as well as forest really makes it difficult. Nearly half of the population is tribal, owned tribe. This is the second largest tribe in India. The largest one is the Bhil tribe, second is the Gond tribe. Gond tribe starts from Gadchiroli and extends up to the Koraput, Kalahandi of Orissa. So it is spread in nearly five states. Gonds have their own lifestyle, 4 months of paddy cultivation by a very primitive way that provides them rice for eating. Remaining 8 months they survive by collecting various forest produce. For example, this old woman has collected mahua flowers in the month of March. She would dry these mahua flowers, store them. These are sweet succulent flowers. So flowers would be used as food, as medicine, as sweetener, as well as for making alcohol. When we went there 30 years ago, roads were very rudimentary, transport didn't exist. So bullock cart was the prevalent mode of transport. Serious women with obstructed labor, serious children had to be transported on bullock carts. And in the entire district, there was only one rudimentary 30-bedded hospital, which was called district hospital. There were no facilities of district hospital, but it was called district hospital. So when you don't have healthcare, and when you also have huge distances which you cannot traverse, what do people do? People create various gods and goddesses. So outside every village, under the mahua tree, you would find such wooden idols. Each idol representing some god or some goddess. But then interestingly, each god or goddess specializes in one disease. So, there is Balki Dev, there is Mariai. So, various goddesses for each disease. One for cholera, one for fever. And people really, because if I don't get access to healthcare, but I need some psychological satisfaction that I have done something for my kin, even if my child dies, unfortunately, I need later on some consolation that I went to God, did something. So these are actually their substitute doctors, one could say. When doctors don't go there, gods go. But then apart from that, something else also, intermittently, you hear huge bomb blasts in Gadchiroli. And for the past 30 years, we also have the Maoist and Naxalite movement going on. Hanora block in which I live is the most violent block in Maharashtra. The maximum number of violent episodes and violence deaths occur there. But before you get too scared of coming to Gadchiroli, let me also tell you that more deaths occur in Mumbai because of railway accidents. So Mumbai is more dangerous than Gadchiroli. And here, Rani and I started this organization, Search, as the logo suggests. We believed that we didn't know how to provide healthcare to the rural and tribal people of India. We were not Sarvagyani, though we had degrees in medicine and gynecology and something from Johns Hopkins, but no. The woods were dark and deep, villages were apart and scattered, nobody reached there, and we did not know how to take healthcare there. So instead of claiming that we have come to provide healthcare there, we thought it's better to say we have come to search. Nearly 30 years later, this is our campus. We call this campus as Shodhagram. There was a mention that I spent my childhood in Mahatma Gandhi's Sevagram Ashram. So my life began in Sevagram and it took me to Shodhagram. Shodhagram, a village from where we search for solutions for providing healthcare. We have a small hospital here, 30-bed hospital, a research center, a training center, and 60 of our colleagues, doctors, nurses, lab technicians, researchers, computer engineers, we all live in this campus. And from here, we work in a surrounding laboratory of 134 villages. These are the 134 villages where we have created an intensive population-based laboratory. For the past 30 years, every single citizen in these villages, every pregnancy, every birth, every child death, and every cause of child death has been recorded. So this is one of the 22 sites world over where such long-term follow-up of population is available and where the mortality rates and causes of death in the population are tracked. So this whole tribe, these 1500 villages of Gadchiroli district, these 134 villages who are our intensive population laboratory, and Shodhagram where we live, this is really the theater in which all I am going to describe happened. So question number one, what are the priority health problems of the people? Before coming to here, I was talking with Dean Professor Supe, and he was telling me how for Indian medical graduates, a competency-based curriculum was attempted. At the end of your medical education, what competency should you have? Should you be able to diagnose a rare sarcoma or some rare syndrome, or should you be able to manage an acute episode of childhood diarrhea and dehydration? Should you be able to manage a rare degenerative neurological disease, or should you be able to manage common disorders, even including snake bites, cerebral malaria, pulmonary tuberculosis? What should you be competent for? What you should be competent for depends on what people need. Medical education, it doesn't have any reason to exist on itself. It has to exist, it has to shape itself depending on what people need. So first question is, what are the priority health problems of the people? And we began 2 months after we went to Gadchiroli. I happen to be a physician, though it was mentioned, I do not have MD in preventive social medicine, but it's in medicine. So I was shown this girl sent by a PSC medical officer, 10-year-old girl. What do you see about her? Pale tongue, though you can't see, but yellow sclera, bloated abdomen. And this girl had a murmur in the heart, and that's why she was really referred to me, assuming that she had rheumatic heart disease. So she appeared like that, but that interest, that bothered me. And I suspected something and got her blood test done, and I found that she had sickle cell anemia. Now, this happened to be the first case of sickle cell anemia reported from Gadchiroli district. As a physician and a young physician at that time, I got very excited that, look, I have found out this disease, which was so far till then was unreported from Gadchiroli. And so we conducted a district sample survey as to what is the prevalence of sickle cell disease in the population. What percentage of people have sickle cell trait? How many have sickle cell anemia? And we collected 3,200 blood samples from randomly selected belonging to different caste groups, and we found that nearly 6,000 people had sickle homozygous, nearly 1 lakh people in the district had sickle cell trait, and the sickle cell had a gradient in different castes. The report was shared in a meeting, and the Minister of Tribal Affairs, Minister, Health Minister, they all very much applauded. They said that search had come here few months ago and it had already discovered such thing. The paper was published, they gave me a state award, but Minister also said that because search is doing great thing in Gadchiroli, we will start a center for tribal medical research in Gadchiroli. Center duly started within 1 year, but it started in Pune, where there are no tribals. Because medical doctors did not want to go to Gadchiroli. So the research center for tribal health went where the doctors stayed, wanted to stay, rather than where tribal lived. So we went back, Rani and I went back to various tribal leaders and villages and told them that look, we had done that survey together and we had found this disease amongst you, but government has opened center in Pune, so we should bring some political pressure. So what did those tribal leaders say? They said, and I had one of my greatest shock of my life. They refused to do anything about the disease. They said, did we ever tell you that this is our problem? You came and you asked for a drop of blood. We thought ki young couple aaya hai US se, jinko kyon naraz kare bhai. So humne aapko ek drop of blood de diya. We have nothing more to do with this problem. Do what you want to do. This is your headache. We realized that there was something seriously wrong in our approach, our method of selecting a priority, or method of conducting research. When we medical minds, when we identify a problem, research should address the need of the community I work with and not the research community I report to. You are not so spoiled so far, most of the students as you are, but we senior people are fairly spoiled people. When we think about any medical problem, subconsciously we are thinking about those conferences, PPTs, presentation that I am going to make, the applause that I am going to get in those conferences. Actually, when the medical researchers do research, they select problems, they are thinking what will be appreciated in the medical conferences. We live amongst people. We do our studies on the people. But with the aim of presenting in some research journals or some medical conferences. And that's where we had gone wrong. People did not feel that sickle was their problem. And imagine, though I told you the numbers, sickle cell trait is nearly asymptomatic. So 6,000 people amongst 12 lakh population was even 0.5% of the population had that morbidity. So people were very right in saying that this is not our health priority. This is your mental age. And since then we decided hereafter, and this we did about in 1987, we decided hereafter we will not do any research in Gadchiroli which will not originate from the needs, problems of the people and which will not benefit the local people. After 30 years, I must say, with a sense of regret, that what we did about the sickle can be called research on the people. Now I feel in hindsight that we used people as guinea pigs. They didn't suffer from that problem so much. It was not their priority. But to satisfy our intellectual curiosity and maybe to get some publications done, we did research on the people. I must say it now, with a sense of regret, that it was research on the people, it was unethical. And our research, our medical priorities must be, so what I would like to call now is research with the people. Not research on the people, but research with the people. So then question is, how do you know what are people's health priorities? So we started meeting people in villages. We started calling village representatives, tribal representatives to show the ground and started organizing what we call tribal health assembly, rural health assembly, in which 50, 100 village representatives participate, and we ask them, what are your health priorities? Tell us your health priorities, and search would do research on those priorities and not the exotic priorities which American journal or a British journal would publish. From the priorities that they mentioned, a long list emerged. How do you know which are higher priorities? So we gave people opportunity to vote. People nowadays are accustomed, every 2 years, 3 years, some election is going on. So even tribal people know how to do voting. So out of the list of 20 health problems, people voted and they selected what they thought were their health priority health problems, and from which we ranked. Do you know what problem might have come as the first priority? You're not very off, but little. The first priority they said was malaria. Second was diarrhea. Third was backache. Fourth was our children die. Fifth was women's white discharge, leukorrhea. Sixth was alcoholism. We have done such series of people's health assemblies. And then the different priorities, now these are not in the order of ranking, but I am grouping them now. This is not how tribal talk, but these are the different priorities which people have expressed at different times. Look really carefully. Do you find any Weber syndrome or Gaucher's disease? Or no syndromes and no disease. Nothing. But these problems have kept us busy for 30 years. I can't claim that we have solved most of the problems, but maybe we have moved a little bit. But then I must tell you at this point one story. One of my greatest professors who ever taught me was Dr. Leon Gordis. He was professor of epidemiology at Johns Hopkins School. When he used to teach us course on epidemiology, students from all over the US used to come to Baltimore just to listen to his lectures on epidemiology. He used to teach us for 2 months, and then whole university campus, the largest hall in the university, couldn't accommodate those number of students. So open TVs were placed in the entire campus, so as if the whole epidemiology world of US used to assemble there. Several years after we came back, started working in Gadchiroli, and I am actually a little preempting, but then after we had done some useful work beyond sickle cell fiasco that I told, he had come to India, so I went to pay my respect to him. So Gordis was an old man, so he asked me, what are you doing there? I told him that the place we have gone to, virtually, what are the major problems we found, how we are trying to address those problems. Sometimes success, sometimes failure, but some of the problems we have been able to solve, especially reducing child mortality. So Gordis, old man, said, Abhay, I am envious of you. Now it's a formal way to say that I am envious of you, but then what I was surprised was, that there were tears in his eyes. He had his cataract surgery done in earlier days, so big convex lenses, so his eyes could be seen, large size, and they were full of tears. I was really taken aback. I said, what happened, Dr. Gordis? He said, look, Abhay, I made my whole career in epidemiology by doing studies, and I am supposed to be the global expert on Gaucher's disease. I don't think I have saved even 5 children's life by this 50 years of work. Because we in the US, we don't have any problem to solve. And so we identify a fraction of a fraction of a fraction problem aur uska chilka nikalte baithte hain. That's called research in the UL. And here you are a lucky couple. You have gone to a place where you pick up a stone and throw and you get a global research problem. I said, yes, maybe we are too small, but the second part that you said is true. Going to Gadchiroli has the enormous advantage of no dearth of problems to be solved, no dearth of research problems to be solved. So the lesson that I learned from that encounter with God is was, go where the problems are and not where the facilities are. Places where there are facilities, you are not welcome. There is already a crowd, there is a long queue waiting there. You become a problem there. So don't crowd there. Even forget the idealism or humanitarian approach, but even as a career wisdom, I'll tell you, don't go where you are not needed. Don't go where there are long queues. Go where places where which are full of problems and there are no queues to go there. You will be the first. You will be the global first. Simple key to the success. And so, now people have told us priority problems. Now second question was, what type of healthcare do people need? So to begin with, what kind of hospital? So again, wizened by our sickle cell fiasco, we started going to villages and started asking people, tribal people, rural people, what kind of hospital do you want? And government has constructed a district hospital, why don't you go there? So they said, we are afraid. What are you afraid of? They said, multi-story buildings. Thank God they did not come to KEM. So they said, multi-story building and huge corridors. We feel lost there, we don't know where to go. So we don't want to go to hospitals or big buildings. Then more, they said that doctors and nurses, they wrap themselves in some white cloth. So he said, to kya hua? Aapka kya bigda? Safed kapde mein lapeta. So they said that we wrap dead bodies in white cloth, white shroud. These doctors and nurses already wrapped themselves in this trouble. How are they going to save us? We don't know. And then they said, the doctor confided now, in those hospitals, there is no God. These doctors consider themselves to be God. But there is no real God. If there is no God, how can there be healing? So, we don't go to hospital. That was their final verdict. So, in consultation with the people of nearly 100 villages, we constructed there a hospital of different kind. Hospital of huts. A tribal friendly hospital. A hospital which should not look like a hospital. A hospital where tribal people, rural people should feel as if they have come to their own village. They have come to their neighborhood. So, hospital of huts, series of huts for indoor, where doctors and nurses can go from hut to hut instead of all patients lined up in the ward. Have you ever been admitted in the wards? Sometimes, general ward? Unlikely, unlikely. You are medical students, you must have had some special privilege. But if you get admitted in a general ward, when I was second year student, I had the misfortune of getting admitted to a general ward. I know. It is such a bad experience. One patient is groaning with the pain in the night and the whole ward cannot sleep. One patient is serious on oxygen and the rest of the ward cannot sleep because they think tomorrow I may also die. You want to put catheters, you want to give enemas, their privacy, their dignity, everything is completely abolished there. So getting admitted to ward is a concept which is designed to suit doctors. So that in one go, I can see 40 patients. So my कॉफी पीने जा सकता हूँ. वार्ड इज अ कंसेप्ट विच इज वेरी सुटेबल फॉर डॉक्टर्स एंड नर्सेस सो दैट फ्रॉम वन स्टेशन दे कैन रियली ओवरसी ऑल द पेशेंट्स इन वन गो. सो इट इज रियली देयर इज सम रैशनल टू इट बट लुक एट थ्रू पेशेंट्स व्यू पॉइंट इट्स वेरी इनकन्वीनियंट एंड पेशेंट्स सेड लुक दिस डॉक्टर्स एंड नर्सेस कम फॉर 5 मिनट्स rest all 23 hours our relatives are taking care of us. Where is the place for them to stay? So relatives say we go back home. So tribal patients say we also go back home. That's why this hospital of huts was created where patients can stay with the family, and most of the time it is the family members who take care of the patients. All small nursing needs and foods and waters and anxiety, pain, who relieves? It's the family members. We believe that we treat them partly. And so hospital should be designed keeping in view the convenience of the family. So hospital of huts are travel friendly. But then there is an operation theater also. And surgeons from all over Maharashtra gradually have started coming to Gadchiroli, including Dr. Shekhar Bhojraj, who is ex-KEM student. His father was also was a professor of anesthesia. And so Shekhar Bhojraj and nearly 50 surgeons from all over Maharashtra come there and regularly conduct elective, planned, specialized surgeries. So we conduct nearly 600 very specialized operations, 40,000 patients in our general OPD. And so hospital care needs to be accessible, homely and friendly, where patient receives respect and dignity is honored and should be affordable. So what sort of health care? This sort of hospital care. Next. But then the question is, what about those who cannot reach hospital? There is an illusion called hospital illusion. That hospital illusion is that all of us, we sit in the hospital and the kind of patients come to us, we believe that every entire population has got similar health problems. But there is a huge bias in the kind of patients that we see in the hospital. Ordinary patients usually don't reach hospital. They don't have to reach hospital. These problems are managed at home or at the primary level. So, higher up in the hierarchy of hospital, if you are at the tertiary care hospital, you practically always see the rare, complicated, serious diseases. And then we tend to believe that everybody has this kind of problem. So we need to know what are the problems of those who do not reach hospital. And mind you, 90% patients never reach hospital. And 99% patients never reach tertiary hospital. And 99.9% patients never reach KEM hospital. So what you see here in the wards, don't think that that represents Maharashtra or India. And so majority don't reach hospital, so then what you do about those who cannot reach hospital and who are those? So let me take one example. Children who die in villages. You know, we measure that by infant mortality rate. Those who of you not have so far learned IMR, infant mortality rate is if 1000 babies are born alive, how many of them die within 1 year? That is infant mortality rate. If 1000 babies are born alive, and suppose in the US, the infant mortality rate in the US is 5. In Sweden, it is 3. In Kerala and Goa, it is 11. 1000 babies born, only 11 die within 1 year. When we measured for the first time infant mortality rate in 100 villages in Gadchiroli, it was 121. Within 1 year, 121 died. And then when we decided causes of death, about 75% of infant deaths were newborn deaths or deaths because of childhood pneumonia. So we thought pneumonia would be an easier problem. So we began with pneumonia. I am cutting short several, there are several anecdotes, several stories, several research data based on which we went on making decisions, but for that maybe we need 3-day workshop. And so what do you do about pneumonia? There was a student like you called Frank Shan. Frank Shan studied pediatrics in Australia. He was an Australian. He is really, I should say. And then for 1 year he went to a tribal area which is connected to Australia in Papua New Guinea. And sitting in Papua New Guinea tribal OPD where he had very little facilities, he started wondering as to how can pneumonia be diagnosed if X-ray facilities are not available. Because he had sometimes X-ray available, sometimes it was out of order, sometimes electricity wasn't there. So Frank Shan did a wonderful clinical study, very simple clinical study. He saw, let's say, 500 patients, children with cough, did X-ray of everybody as a part of the research study, and also measured various clinical parameters of those 500. And from that, he inferred that if you only count respiratory rate of a child with cough, you can diagnose childhood pneumonia with 87% certainty. It was a great discovery because it applied. At that time, there were 4 million pneumonia childhood deaths world over. Frank Shan's this simple research opened the gates of how pneumonia could be managed without X-ray, even without stethoscopes. What you need? Count breath of a child with cough. So we thought of applying that method in Gadchiroli for this pneumonia. We designed a field trial, but then the next challenge was there were very few literate women in Gadchiroli villages. This is year 1988. So we thought of making use of illiterate dyes. Now dyes couldn't count respiratory rate. And by that time Frank Shan and WHO were saying that if a child with cough, if a neonate has cough, or if neonate has a respiratory rate more than 60, most likely it is pneumonia. If post neonate infant has a respiratory rate of 50 or more than 50 and cough, most likely pneumonia. So how do you teach illiterate dyes to diagnose childhood pneumonia? Without stethoscope, without X-ray. She couldn't even count more than 12. Why 12? Why could she count up to 12? Dozen. Old women, British era. They knew dozen. Banana kaise kharitne hai, kela kaise kharitne hai. आप लोगों की जनरेशन में शायद नहीं खरीदते हैं, पहले डजन से खरीदते थे, केला डजन में खरीदते थे, तो डजन का मतलब होता है 12. एनीवे, सो नाउ देयर काउंटिंग लिमिट वाज 12, सो आई हैड टू डिवाइस समथिंग विद इन द लिमिट्स ऑफ 12, बट टू बी एबल टू डायग्नोस न्यूमोनिया विद अ रेस्पिरेटरी रेट ऑफ 60 और 50, सो आई डिजाइन दिस सिंपल इक्विपमेंट व्हिच एट दैट टाइम आई कॉल्ड इट ब्रेथ काउंटर. What does it have? It has a 1 minute, sorry, office level. It has a 1 minute sand timer. This I bought from the toy shop in Nagpur. 10 rupees. And then like abacus, it has got 2 rows of beads. This row is for neonates and this row is for post neonates, infant. There are pictures here of neonates and infants to remind her which row belongs to which. If she has a child with cough, what she is to do, first make the child quiet and then count respiratory rate. And then turn this upside down, so the sand watch has started. Count respiration, and with every 10 breaths she would move one bead, if suppose it is a neonate. So with every 10 breaths she would move one bead, third, fourth, before the sand passed, which means before the 1 minute was completed, if the red bead moved, it meant child has pneumonia. She she doesn't know 50 or 60 or 70 or 67 or 72. She doesn't have wristwatch. But using this simple equipment, illiterate dyes could diagnose pneumonia, and then I did a comparative study which was later on published in the Lancet of comparison of my diagnosis using stethoscope versus TBA's diagnosis, dyes diagnosis using breath counter. Their diagnosis matched my diagnosis in 82% of cases. They became 83%. Now we knew how to provide pneumonia treatment to children in villages where there are no doctors. And using this equipment, and I am not going in the complete setup of how do we provide. Here one of the dai who has been trained in that. And so look, when these kind of workers, these dais and other male community health workers started treating pneumonia, before we started this, the case fatality rate in pneumonia in children was 13.5%. Of all the babies or children who developed pneumonia, clinical signs suggestive of pneumonia. We don't know 100% that these were pneumonias, but clinically suspicion of pneumonia, 13.5% died. With this diagnosis and treatment, in the very first year, case fatality came down to less than 1%. This study started in 1988. Pneumonia field trial was published again in the Lancet in 1990. It became a global program in 1993. Currently, it is in operation in 77 countries, the ARI management program. And our workers have continued to treat pneumonia in children in Gadchiroli using simple respiratory criteria and co-tramoxazole. Still no resistance pattern has emerged and the case fatality for the 30 years has remained less than 1%. And then the next challenge, what do you do about neonates? Even more difficult challenge. Because A, I am not a pediatrician. And so I was not expert. Thank God I was not an expert. Otherwise, I wouldn't have dared to do the stupidities that we did. And about newborn, WHO guidelines at that time in bold letters said, sick newborn is a very serious affair. Don't even touch it. Don't try to do anything in the community. Send immediately to hospital. But what do I do? This is 350 kilometers long district where transport is the bullock cart and there is only one hospital. So hospital is a notion. Hospital is not a reality for those villages, for those tribal neonate baby. And traditions were that babies were not allowed to even step out of, to be out, taken out of the home. The, usually the hut has or home has one the darkest, dirtiest, smallest room that is selected as home delivery room. The woman delivers there. For next 12 days, she is not allowed to step out. So even baby is not allowed to come out. And the newborn care which was provided in traditional way in home was like this. Now look at that old lady. She might be dai, she might be grandmother, I don't remember. And the old, the mother, postpartum mother, exhausted, pain, is still lying on this charpai. Room is dark, there is no window, there is no ventilation. Nobody is allowed to enter there except the old woman. And here is the baby. Doesn't look very low birth weight. But then, a naked baby being provided, exposed to outside cold weather, would get hypothermic. And look at this cow dung plaster. Trillions of bacteria and baby's bare arm. Look at those dusty soles and look at baby's scalp. It will be surprising if these babies don't get hypothermia, hypoglycemia, or if they don't get infection, neonatal sepsis. And when they got those things, where were the hospitals? As we said, too far away. Next please. Now, is there something else here? And next. Okay, so because hospitals were not accessible, we decided if babies cannot go to hospital, hospital must go where the babies are. Babies are in these homes, huts, they are not going to reach hospital. And so in every village we selected one woman, a literate woman, as a newborn care expert. She is one such woman, her name is Kajubai. Kajubai is from a village called Abhay, 7th fail girl. At that time she was young when we selected her. This is probably, she is relatively young. Her husband was alcoholic, subsequently he died of tuberculosis. This was a Dalit woman, but very keen to do something, learn something, do something for village, rise from where she was stuck. Next please. So 39 such women were selected from 39 villages and they were trained to examine a newborn baby, provide health education to mother, examine mother also, diagnose illnesses in baby and mother and manage these illnesses at home. It was a field trial, 39 villages intervention area, 47 villages control area. We started in 1993 measuring the baseline. Next. Here, one of the Arugyutus, Mayabai, is giving health education to pregnant women using flip chart. Various messages about what pregnant women should eat, ANC care, immunization, iron folic acid. From there to how could you take care of your baby? Next. And here, after the baby is born, the Arugyutus makes visit, usually 7 home visits in 28 days. Takes history of the baby, measures temperature, weighs the baby, so she has birth weight, she has progressive birth weight of the weight gain of the baby. She also identifies whether baby is preterm and she also diagnoses neonatal sepsis. Next. Babies who were low birth weight, preterm, these were two babies born low birth weight. One was 1200 gram, another was 1400 gram. So you can see how shriveled their skins are, but you also see that the house flies sitting here, here, here. So what would happen of these babies at home? Very unlikely to survive. Next. Because we didn't have incubator, we created this kind of mountaineering bag, sleeping bags. We used to keep them in those, keeping them warm, close to mother. Next. And those babies who had signs symptoms of neonatal sepsis, we treated them by giving the Arogya Dut, it is the same Kajubai, to give injection gentamicin. Now, here are two questions. Can you diagnose neonatal sepsis without culture reports? Yes, very difficult. Even the greatest neonatologist, if you read at all textbook of neonatal, usually they originate from Boston. So, these textbooks of neonatology invariably mention that neonatal sepsis is a highly fatal disease. You don't get much time. So, at the slightest clinical suspicion, don't wait for bacteriological reports, start antibiotics. And at that time, two antibiotics were injection ampicillin and injection gentamicin. These were the recommended antibiotics. If you do not have culture sensitivity report, then blindly start these two antibiotics. We prepared a simple clinical algorithm by comparing with the diagnosis of neonatal sepsis by the professor of neonatology at the All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Dr. Vinod Paul, you might be using his textbook. So Vinod diagnosed neonatal sepsis and based on those sign symptoms which were present in those babies, we devised a simple clinical algorithm. You have those modified Jones criteria for acute rheumatic fever. I don't know if you still use them. Do you? You. Okay. So like modified Jones criteria, we developed neonatal sepsis clinical criteria. I'm not showing all those criteria right now, but they are already published in international journals. And then we compared that using this criteria, if Arogya Duts are trained to apply this criteria, doesn't have stethoscope, doesn't need any lab facility. Based on clinical signs and symptoms, if any two of those seven signs and symptoms are present, for us it is neonatal sepsis. And then our sensitivity is 26%. Specificity is 98%. And do you know what is the sensitivity of neonatal sepsis diagnosis made by the neonatologist in Boston? I am comparing published data. Sensitivity, or how many of the neonatal sepsis whom the leading American neonatologists suspect that these babies have sepsis and they start them antibiotic, only 5% of them turn out to be true sepsis. So there only 5% diagnosis is correct, while our Arugyadus 26% of the time diagnosis is correct. Here we do accept lower level of sensitivity or correctness because neonatal sepsis is a very elusive diagnosis. If it fools American neonatologists 95% of the time, it's obvious that it's very elusive diagnosis. And injection gentamicin and ampicillin. So we trained her to use injection gentamicin, oral cotrimaxone. Look at the impact of this field trial. Now what you see here is NMR, neonatal mortality rate. 1,000 babies born, how many die within 28 days? Neonatal rate. Now the yellow line is the control area where we were only monitoring what was happening. Government programs were going on here, 47 villages. Here, as you can see, NMR, baseline NMR 93 to 95 was at 58, and for the next 10 years, it only randomly fluctuated but usually remained at or above 60. If control villages really represented what was happening all over India. So for nearly 10 years, we didn't do much for the neonates in India. And these were the intervention villages. 39 villages where we introduced home-based newborn care, baseline NMR 62, and within 3 years it came down to the level of 26. Here our trial was over, research trial was over, and then we continued here as service program, and NMR continued to remain around at 25 or 26. In comparison to the control area, 70% reduction in the NMR. Something very funny happened. When I sent this for publication to the Lancet, Lancet naturally sent it to reviewers. One leading neonatologist from South Africa emailed me. I'm not going to reveal his name. He was the reviewer of my manuscript. He said that I am supposed not to contact you, but I cannot conceal my enthusiasm and excitement that something like this has happened in the villages and tribal areas, that the NMR is decreased by 70%. He said further that if NMR in the US decreases by 5% by any new drug or any new intervention, it becomes the headline in the US. And here you are, some obscure place called Gadchiroli from where your manuscript comes, you have reduced it by 70%. This paper was published in the Lancet, but let me come before that. Look at the impact on the IMR. So when we began, IMR was 121. With pneumonia management that you already saw, it came down to around 80. You would see a random fluctuation, but ignore them. Look at the trend from 120 to 80. And with home-based newborn care, IMR further reduced and reduced and reduced and finally settled at the level of 30. Gadchiroli remained poor. Gadchiroli remained remote, Gadchiroli remained semi-literate, Gadchiroli remained away from hospitals, Gadchiroli remained deprived of doctors, and yet these ordinary looking women have reduced the IMR of Gadchiroli from 121 to 30. Merely coincidence that after 2003, government of India chose reducing IMR of India to the level of 30 as the national goal. did this miracle? Same with Ajubai, 20 years later. You can see her hair is great now. But this is what she has. These are the equipments which we give her for home-based newborn care in her kit. Potramoxol antibiotic, Ambu bag, digital thermometer, vitamin K and vitamin gentamicin, insulin syringes to give injections so that they are pre-sterilized, disposable. And this is the record. Next. And she carries all this on a shoulder bag. But with this bag on her shoulder, with knowledge in her head, skills in her hands, and compassion in her heart, she becomes a mobile NICU. And again, I did not make a rhetorical statement because we have published in international journal, in the Journal of Perinatology of American Pediatric Association, comparison of case fatality rates of newborns of various periods of gestation and birth weight in 13 hospitals, secondary level hospital in India, and Kajubais and 39 such workers. Their case fatality rates are similar. So really, it's not an exaggeration. These trained community health workers under proper training, proper supervision, proper supply system and also economic financial incentives. But they can provide home-based newborn care which matches the care given in the secondary level hospitals. Next. So this model is essentially an empowerment model. This is our logo of home-based newborn care. What does it signify? Look, this home was dark. That mother was alone. And she had no hope about this baby, how to save the baby. She opened one window of knowledge, one window of opportunity, and that woman, who could be mother, who could be Arogya Dut, but she becomes empowered. She lifts the entire family on her empowered hands and the baby at her bosom. This study was again published in the Lancet. I already told you that reviewer was too excited even before it published. But then, something happened further. Lancet editor and history department decided to select what they call vintage papers ever published in the Lancet's 180 years of history. And they selected certain papers. In 19th century, you have paper of Robert Koch. In 1906, probably, you have paper of Ronald Ross declaring that how malaria is transmitted by mosquitoes. In 1920, you have paper of Binting and Best, history of insulin. Somewhere around 1940, there is a paper of Alexander Fleming, penicillin. And in 1990, when you come, there is one paper from Gadchiroli called Home-based. Knowledge, power of scientific research and evidence is such that this study has been replicated several times by us in Maharashtra, by Indian Council of Medical Research in India, by Johns Hopkins University in Bangladesh, by Aga Khan University in Pakistan. Everywhere it has reduced newborn and infant mortality. So then it became national policy of Government of India. In 2011, home-based newborn care by ASHA became part of the national policy. Actually, the ASHA program, I hope you know about ASHA, community health worker at the village level, has been designed primarily on two models. One, the Mitanin model in Chhattisgarh and home-based newborn care model, Arogya Dut in Gadchiroli. Currently, 8 lakh ASHAs are trained to provide home-based newborn care. Training was designed in Gadchiroli on the lines of how we train these 39 workers. It's a standardized training manual DVD set, using which we first trained 400 national and state trainers. They went back and they trained 5,000 district trainers who have trained 8 lakh ASHAs. In 2017-18, 16-17, Health Ministry tells me that 1.1 crore newborn babies in India received home-based newborn care. And my friend Tony Costello, who is currently head of the MCH, Maternal Childhood Division in WHO, he recently wrote that based on the home visiting and home-based newborn care principle, currently 80 countries are providing newborn care in their countries. The Director General of WHO, Dr. Tedros, who recently became DG of WHO, earlier he was Health Minister of Ethiopia. From somewhere he heard that something different has happened in Gadchiroli. So he sent very high level delegation, he sent two teams ladies for training in how to provide pneumonia treatment and how to provide home-based newborn care to children and neonates in villages. And he implemented this pattern in the whole of Ethiopia. So this has become now a global pattern. But more important than global pattern for you, what is more important is the power of research, the power of new knowledge. Look, what was Gadchiroli? Who knows Gadchiroli even today? Gadchiroli is known more for Naxalites and bomb blasts than anything else. Mrs. Sudha Murthy wanted to come to visit us in Gadchiroli, but she was advised by her security advisor, it is dangerous to go to Gadchiroli. So Gadchiroli is an unknown place, search is an unknown entity, Abhay and Rani Bang are unknown people, somewhere remote place, our hands are weak, and those Kaju Bhais and those community health workers are small people in villages. But it is the power of knowledge and evidence that can change, that can alter national and global policy. Remember the same WHO which was saying in 1990 that newborns can be managed only in hospital. In 2009, WHO and UNICEF and USAID and Save the Children made a global declaration that when hospital care is not available, the best approach to manage newborn is by home-based newborn care. Based on the evidence, you can change the mindset, the thinking and the policies and program. Nearly 2000 years ago, Archimedes made a statement in his king's court. He said that give me a liver long enough and a place to stand outside earth and with my old weak hands, I can move the entire earth. You must have known this. And so of course all the courtiers and the king, everybody laughed. They ridiculed him. But we know from the principle of liver now that what he said is principally correct. If you have a liver long enough and if you have a place to stand outside earth, yes, you can move the earth. Research, science is that long liver. If you can stand outside the system, the mainstream system doesn't allow you unorthodox thinking. It will always say that you need ventilators and incubators and NICUs for saving neonates. Because the entire science of neonatology and business of neonatal hospital depends on that. But you need a place to stand outside the system where you can do bold experiments. And liver of science, the weak people and weak places of Gadchiroli can change the global policies. So what I have tried to share with you are a few stories. And how much time do I have?
We are already over.
So let me skip over the last story.
No!
Your classes will be over here.
No.
So let's quickly go through the last story. And the question 4 is, yes, child mortality is reduced, but now epidemiologic transition happening even in Gadchiroli. And stroke, hypertension, diabetes, heart attack and cancers are becoming the leading causes of adult mortality. How do you deal with this? These are not so simple as malaria or pneumonia or newborn care, more complex, more difficult. There is no one single cause. Next. The Global Burden of Disease study recently published and the risk factors which cause disease and death world over, and the two of the top 10 causes are tobacco and alcohol. Next. I met this girl in a tribal village called Yerkat. Rani and I were passing in the jeep, and then we saw that by the roadside near a hand pump, this girl was cleaning her teeth at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I got very excited. I thought that with our 30 years of work in Gadchiroli, now even tribal children are so health conscious that they are cleaning their teeth twice a day, thrice a day. So I stopped our vehicle, got down, patted that girl. So the old women sitting there started laughing. And they said, "Doctor, she cleans her teeth every 2 hours." What was she cleaning with? So I looked at the pouch. It was tobacco powder. That 8-year-old tribal girl was addicted to nicotine. And every 2 hours she was getting withdrawal. And she needed subsequent dose. And those who know, there's this called nas, as they call in Marathi, snuff. It's a tobacco powder, and women often clean their teeth with snuff. So she got addicted. Submucous absorption through gums and the oral mucosa of nicotine. If this was happening to 8-year-old girl, next please, we did a district sample survey. Now this, I have a bad habit of whichever problem actually, our clinical problems are thrown before me like this, I start investigating what is the quantum, what is the magnitude. So we did a district sample survey and we found that prevalence of use of tobacco, all ages combined, was 44%. And people were spending from their pocket 293 crore rupees per year on tobacco or purchasing tobacco. Forget the health ill effects and its cost. Out of pocket expenditure 293 crore rupees. And just for comparison, government of Maharashtra that year entire district development and welfare program budget was 157 crore. So you can imagine how tobacco, and next please, and similar survey next year of alcohol amongst men only, because women don't drink and children also don't drink, this survey. So the prevalence among males was 41% and the estimated money spent was 80 crore rupees. Next. And so together money spent on alcohol, tobacco was 373 crore rupees per year by this 1.2 million population. Poor, backward, semi-tribal, and this, and imagine the number of strokes and heart attacks and cancers that this will produce. And the worst part is that Gadchiroli has prohibition against alcohol. And Maharashtra has got prohibition against scented tobacco. Now you did not laugh. So Mumbai and Gadchiroli are on the same plane. In spite of prohibition by government of Maharashtra against, let's say, scented tobacco, gutka, mawa, everything is illegal. But you just walk on the footpath of Mumbai and you walk on the footpath of Gadchiroli. The cancer producing substances are being openly sold. If Gadchiroli is spending 293 crore rupees, I don't know how much Maharashtra is spending and Mumbai is spending. So, prohibition alone doesn't work. But then, I know why you laughed. You thought that prohibition is a failure. It's not. Prohibition works partially. We have another comparative study of adjacent district where there was no prohibition and Gadchiroli district. And we have done comparison of two districts by a cross-sectional survey. We found that prohibition reduced alcohol consumption by nearly 50%. Glass is half full. Whether you would like to call it failure or success depends on your perspective. Those who want to drink, they want to say this is failure. And so, half full. Prohibition works partially, but is not 100% successful. But nothing is 100% successful. Is cancer treatment 100% successful? So have you start laughing at the cancer treatment? No. So no problem has got 100% solution usually, except for smallpox eradication. Most of the problems are solved incrementally. Prohibition cuts down alcohol consumption by 50%, but for subsequent reduction, you need something more. Chief Minister of Maharashtra announced in State Assembly that we will look at the results of Gadchiroli and Chandrapur and then decide about rest of the Maharashtra. So I put before him one proposal. If in spite of prohibition, this much is the alcohol tobacco consumption in Gadchiroli, and he spent nearly 45 minutes understanding the whole survey and its results. And so my proposal was that we will launch in collaboration with Government of Maharashtra this district program called Muktipath towards alcohol and tobacco free Gadchiroli. Towards. We will never reach zero alcohol and tobacco, we know that. But what you can do is to move towards that as a public health program, and the strategy would be, the goal would be to reduce the use and the money spent on alcohol and tobacco by 50% in 3 years. Even this is very optimistic, because again, as I was saying, if tobacco reduction occurs 3%, 5% anywhere, it is celebrated. We are aiming for 50% reduction in 3 years. Next. And the strategies thought are, you need to reduce demand and you need to reduce supply of alcohol and tobacco. For demand reduction, mass awareness, where people even do not know that tobacco produces cancer, oral submucous fibrosis, and so many non-communicable diseases. So when the children cry, parents give tobacco to babies. Babies become quiet. So it's used as pacifier. Same thing happens in opium areas, where opium is given to babies and babies become opium addict. I have seen that on the borders of Rajasthan and Pakistan. So similar phenomena. So you must make communities aware about the ill effects of alcohol and tobacco. And then those who are addicted, you need to provide de-addiction care. For supply reduction, you need community action, community vigilance to cut down alcohol and tobacco availability in the village. And then, if government has already banned it, ban must be enforced honestly and rigorously. So this is the four-pronged strategy with which we have launched a grand experiment called Muktipath at the district level. Next. To my knowledge, this is some of the awareness material. Those who understand Marathi would understand. The noose in the nose. So it's called yesan in Marathi. So tobacco addiction is like a noose in your nose. So todel, to sutel. Next. Mass awareness program. We invited Makrand Anaspure, a very, very popular Marathi actor, and burning tobacco, public burning of tobacco only. Next. Actually, this has already become old data. But then 320 villages have organized and they have introduced ban against alcohol. Other 60 villages have resolved to stop alcohol, but there are 232 villages who are complaining to us that we cannot stop alcohol because there are wounds in our villages. So we need external help, police help. As I said, this is already old data. Just 1 week ago, the latest data I have is 480 villages have stopped alcohol in their villages, and then now people are moving further ahead. 48 villages have put complete ban on both alcohol as well as tobacco. And in such remote places and in 1600 villages, no government can monitor on a daily basis. It's only communities who can monitor. So when community get organized and they decide that it's too much harmful for us and we must put stop on this, it partially works. Next. Then alcoholic addicts. So we have started a de-addiction program actually, and don't tell it to anybody else. Police are supposed to introduce or exercise prohibition. But there is a huge problem of alcohol addiction amongst policemen. So we have started first de-addiction program for police. applause goes to the speech of Gadchiroli, who had this courage to say that my police force is adequate and first they need treatment before we ask them to stop alcohol in the village. So this de-addiction program for police in Gadchiroli has been started, and now we are introducing community de-addiction program in several villages. So four-pronged strategy in collaboration with Government of Maharashtra, people of Gadchiroli, search and Tata Trust, and skip the next slide, because skip it. Okay. Why? Because I don't know to tell you the results at this stage. Results are still, process is going on. After 1.5 years, we will know how successful are we. Through an annual survey of the entire, random sample survey of the entire district, we are independently monitoring the alcohol and tobacco consumption, prevalence, and the money spent on these two. These are our two indicators to measure success or failure. From 1.5 years from now, if you invite me again, I will be able to tell you the results of Optimus. Friends, so we heard four questions and four solutions. How to select the health priorities? Ask the people. We medical people never ask. Actually, when we see a patient, what do we do? What do we do first? We ask history. But when it comes to planning healthcare system, we never ask people, what do you need? We decide ourselves. We experts decide ourselves, what do people need? And so, ask people through people's health assemblies and counseling, but also backed by scientific surveys. So, asking people and also collecting population-based survey data, you can get the concrete grip as to what are the priorities of people. What you see in the hospital are not necessarily priorities of people. Or often, you don't see priorities in the hospital. Next, what kind of hospital? People-friendly community hospital. Next, how to provide care in the community? Community health workers. Home-based newborn care was just one application of the very concept of simplifying, delegating and giving power to community health workers. Next, and how to control social determinants? Combination of these multiple approaches. Next, please. Now the last question. Who would do it? These are the young boys and girls from Maharashtra under the initiative called Nirman. We have thrown up this challenge to the youth of Maharashtra. That making money is not the only fulfillment in the life. There is so much of money everywhere that any amount that you would assemble, you would gather and hold, you are always going to remain poor. The one man in the history of mankind who earned maximum amount of money in his lifetime, who is he? Bill Gates. Never had one single man earned so much money in his lifetime. Never. People might have inherited, sultans and nawabs might have inherited wealth. Not earned. But this man, when he became the global number one, what does he say? I was aspiring to climb here, but there is nothing here. There is no fulfillment. I am only global number one. So what do I do with it? Eat it. And there, his wife Melinda came forward. That Bill, let's do something else. And that's the beauty of woman's heart. Bill was master of making money, collecting money, making algorithms, selling, marketing, patenting. But Melinda told him, how can you make use, humane use of this money? And so they launched the Melinda Gates Foundation. You know about it, so I won't go into it. But then there is something surprising that happened. That Bill and Melinda Gates gave maybe something like $30-40 billion for social causes. So Bill Gates became number two. Somebody else became number one. And you know the cutthroat competition to become the global richest person. So Warren Buffett, the investment guru, became number one. So Warren Buffett, after becoming number one, said, there is nothing here. Warren Buffett also gave away $37 billion of his wealth for social cause. But then something, again another miracle happened. He said, I know how to make money, but I don't know how to spend money for social causes. So he gave that $37 in the hands of his arch rival Bill Gates. That Bill, you know it better than me, how to make social use of this money. But friends, we are living in this era of Bill Gates and Warren Buffett. This is also era of Donald Trump and many other people. But ignore them. For your generation, which has to stay on this earth for next 50 years, you must look at the optimistic future. And Bill Gates and Warren Buffett are telling you that making money cannot be the primary fulfillment of life. It cannot be the primary goal of life. You need some money, but it's like vehicle. You need shoe also. Money is like a shoe in the foot. Keep it there. Don't put it on your head. And so, human life needs some larger cause, larger than myself. I'm too small. Everybody is too small. And when we place ourselves in the center of everything, we practically, one should say, we then get a mental disease called narcissism or selfieism, which practically everybody has nowadays. So, Nirman is a challenge before the youth of Maharashtra that there is something larger in the life. Discover it. Discover it for yourself. Discover how you can connect to the larger causes where people need you. So Nirman is a group of such students. Next. This is one medical doctor, Bhushan, who has come to Gadchiroli and who is working in tribal area in nearly 70 villages. And I am very happy to tell you that many of the youth students from KEM have joined Nirman. Some of you have already visited Gadchiroli, lived in Gadchiroli. Nishan Sancheti, Mayur Bhanarkar, they received me yesterday at the airport, so I must thank them. But there is a group in now KEM. 20 medical students from KEM applied for the next batch of Nirman. I see a wave of change happening. In an era where medical students, when they get admission in the first year, they start preparing for MCQs of the BG examination. There is a group of medical students in KEM who are also thinking beyond, what beyond medical education, what beyond specialization, what am I going to do with all this? Go where the problems are and not where the facilities are. Next. And so, the search in everybody's life continues. Don't go by the given answers. Don't go by the answers given by your seniors, super specialist in this profession. Don't go by MCI presidents who make 1800 crore rupees. Don't go by those dreams and icons. But search in your own life, where am I needed? And what better use can I make of my life and connect these two? Thank you so much.
Speech and oration. Now I would like Meherin to honor our chief guest, look at the momentum.
ज्या प्रोजेक्टरच्या साईडला सेट करून ठेवलं होतं मी.
Your own Gadchiroli somewhere, sometime. Thank you.
Dr. Padmaja Samant ma'am, our Vice President, to conclude today's session.
Have we ever seen the hall this packed and audience in rapt attention? And thank you so much, sir. It was extremely inspiring. Now I do the last formality of vote of thanks. I would like to thank Dr. Kothari's family very much for being with us in this. Dr. Supesh sir, Dr. Pandya sir, Dr. Lupa Mehta madam for trying hard to get Dr. Abhay Bang sir here, all the volunteers of MH division and all the heads of departments and colleagues who are present here, the MLT staff and all of you. Thank you.